Good morning. Welcome to Fairview. So glad you chose to join us today to worship the King of Kings this morning. Stand with us as we sing, Open the Eyes of My Heart. Turn to your neighbor or someone next to you and say, I'm glad to see you here today. Glad to see you here today. You. Come on.
Eyes of my heart, open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you, I want to see you, open the eyes of my heart, Lord, open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you. See you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
One more time.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Do you? You want to see him?
I want to see you. You high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Father God, we thank you for this time, this journey that you have us on, a life, this time, and history. Pray that you just anoint this place, fill us with your heart, with your love, open our eyes that we may see your glory, that we may see you working in and around us. Give us opportunity to love people like you loved us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just some scripture with you this morning. Psalm 34:8 says, O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. And then Psalm 84:11, For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. Psalm 145:9, the Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. Psalm 119:68 says, you are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. Nahum 1:7 says, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. He knows those who take refuge in him. And the Bible just keeps going about how good God is. There's so many verses that we could pick from. That talk about his goodness in different ways and other attributes that he has. But this next song that we sing talks about his goodness in our lives and how it chases us down. And I know for me, this past month has a lot going on. It's been busy. It's been a lot of aggravations, as someone put it the other day, things that just weren't in my plan but were a part of God's. But God has been so good through it all. And I know that through all of these struggles, he's doing something better than I can imagine. And he's working all things for his glory and for my good. So this morning, regardless of what's going on in your life, know that God is good. That's just who he is. We can't change that regardless of how crazy the world we live in is. God is good. So this morning, just meditate on that as we sing and join us as we sing about the goodness of God. Been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all
faithful. And all my life you have been so.
shouts of praise. Amen. Amen. In Christ alone, my hope is found. Amen. So I hope your life is built on Christ. It talks about being built on a solid rock and being built on sand. A lot of things are crumbling right now. A lot of things that people have put their trust in is crumbling. But I guarantee you, you put your trust in Jesus, he'll never fail you and never let you down.
Till on that cross.
seated. Pulling up an old song this morning, just thinking about talking about faith and how, what faith looks like. We walk by faith and not by sight. If you go by sight of what you see going on around you, it can be kind of depressing. But when we walk in faith, when we trust God that he is good, his character is he is good. He wants what's best for us so much that he loves us so much that he sent his only son, Jesus, to die for us. That being said, that thought would captivate us that if we would anchor our hope and our trust and everything that we have is a such thing as being all in. I think a lot of times we as believers, sometimes we start to straddle the fence. We don't, because things don't look so good and we don't really know. And when we think that God works all things for our good and for his glory, the good, the bad, the ugly. Boy, don't you wish we could skip the bad and the ugly sometimes and just feast on the good? So when we're in a good season, we need to feast on it because life happens. Amen? Things happen to us. People get sick. People pass on. You know, we get hurt. We get feelings hurt. We get all these emotions that flood us from time to time, and we feel alone and we feel secluded. There's a lot going on right now about mental health. There's big things about people being secluded so much. You know, I can see that where I work when we have to quarantine and people are quarantined to the room. It's like you see them mentally. They start withdrawing, and then they socially, they don't know how to feel when they first come out of the room. One lady said, she said, I want to go back to my room. She said, I don't like all these people. Well, before, she was new and she was kind of used to everybody, but she spent 3 weeks in a room, and now it doesn't feel comfortable to come out and be around people. If our hope is not in Christ and anchored in Christ, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to withdraw. We're going to seclude. We're not called to be in seclusion. We're called to be impact the kingdom. Impact for the kingdom is being out in the world, being among them, being doctors, lawyers, school teachers, mechanics, farmers, teachers, whatever, store clerks, whatever your call is, floor men or maintenance men or whatever you do, or cutting hair or mowing grass or whatever your profession, whatever your line of work is, that's where you are to impact. That's your ministry. So smile. God loves you. He has you. He knows right where you are. He hadn't forgot you. I want to tell you a little bit about that right here. The anchor holds.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea, by faith alone, sight unknown. And yet his eyes watching me, the anchor holds. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, as I face the raging sea, the anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had visions, and I've had dreams.
they would slip right through. Like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. Face the raging sea, the anchor holds in spite of the storm. Well, I have been young, but I'm older now. And there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life. Oh, that's where God proved His love. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the break. In spite of the storm, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea, the anchor holds in spite of the storm.
It. Being sure of our hope, convinced of what we can't see. By faith, we understand the world was set in order at God's command. By faith, Abel offered God a greater sacrifice than Cain, and for his faith, God commended him as righteous. By faith, Noah trusted God and constructed an ark for the deliverance of his family. By faith, Abraham was willing to sacrifice Isaac, his only son, believing God would still fulfill his promises. By faith, Moses chose to be mistreated with the people of God rather than enjoy sin's fleeting pleasure. By faith, God's chosen nation crossed the Red Sea on dry ground and praised Him as it swallowed up the Egyptians. By faith, Rahab the prostitute escaped destruction because she welcomed the spies in peace. Time will fail me if I tell of Gideon, David, and the prophets. By faith, they administered justice, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire. But others were imprisoned, murdered, and wandered in deserts, mountains, and openings in the earth. We are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. So get rid of every weight, of every sin, and run. Run with endurance the race set before us. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. He is the champion and guide of our faith. For promised joy, he endured the cross, thought nothing of its shame, and having risen again, has been handed his deserved glory at the right hand of the throne of God.
Well, I hope you do. Copy of God's word, please turn to Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to unpack a few things this morning from about faith. Learning about faith. Faith is such an important part of every believer. Every person alive today has been given a measure of faith by God to be able to believe and trust in Him as Lord and Savior. Hebrews 11:1 said, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what is visible." Today we're going to look at, by faith, we're going to look at Abraham. Abraham, Father Abraham. We know many, there's a song about Father Abraham. There's all kind of things about Father Abraham. He's the father of our faith. And he's commended by so many things about looking back, how he was one of the first things of really showing by faith how he trusted God. So we're going to kind of open that up today, looking at verse 8. We're going to pick up in verse 8, going through the heroes of the faith. We got to think now, this is in the New Testament. He's going back to the Old Testament, to the very beginning, went to Genesis, and he's captivating, kind of showing us snippets. We're going to catch a little glimpse right here, verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land. Like a stranger in a foreign country, he lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him to the same promise. For he was looking forward to a city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Father God, thank you for the reading of your word. Open our eyes that we may see. Lord, help us to glean and be encouraged by your word today. Lord, may we live by faith. May you find us faithful when you come again, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen, amen, amen. Several things about verse 8. We're going to look at it. Pick up first. He heard God's call. Turn to Genesis 12. Let's pick up. Let's see what Abraham, how he heard it. What happened when Abraham heard God's call? Genesis chapter 12, we're going to read a little bit of the story of Abraham. Genesis chapter 12. If you're there, say amen. All right, verse 1. The Lord had said to Abraham, "Go from your country, your people, your father's household, to a land I will show you." Here's the first covenant. "I will make you a covenant," is a promise of God. "I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the people on the earth will be blessed through you." So Abraham went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. This being said, Abraham heard God's call.
God is still calling people today. He's still calling. He's still drawing. He's still pursuing us. God's goodness is pursuing us in the fact that He's still calling us unto salvation today. Many people say, well, I'll get saved when I get ready to. That's not how this works. You call when the Holy Spirit is drawing you. It says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. This is how salvation happened. This is the first call of God that every believer comes the same way. There's no 1, 2, 3 steps. Well, I'm gonna miss the first 2 steps and go to step 3. Now, I've been putting some stuff together before. Some assembly requires when it says it on the outside of the box. And sometimes I don't read the instructions and I skip 1, 2, and 3 and I go to number 4. In just a few minutes, I realize that something messed up. I got all these extra parts here. Where do they go? The same happens with salvation. You can't skip 1, 2, and 3. God has a plan, step by step. Number 1 is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. With all your heart, mind, soul, love Him with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Believe on Him, confess Him, and you shall be saved. A lot of people say they believe in the Lord. A lot of people confess in the Lord. Just belief is not enough. It has to make a difference in your life. It changed your life. It was a new manager moved in. A lot of times when we have, if you worked in a corporation or on a job or had different managers or bosses come in and manage the place, you had a new management come in, they always liked to change stuff up, didn't they? Man, we had it going so good and so, but a new manager comes in. It's kind of like before Jesus. When Jesus comes in, it kind of interrupts our life. But the thing is, I'd rather do it God's way. I'd rather do it God's way right here, follow His instructions, because He don't leave anything out. He has a perfect plan for you and me. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whosoever, does that leave anybody out? That whosoever believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. That was the plan from the get-go. You know, that was Nicodemus. That's the story of Nicodemus. He goes and said, what must I do to be saved? What can I do to inherit eternal life? How can I do this? Do I enter a second time? He said, marvel not, you must be born again. He said, do I need to enter in a second time to my mother's womb? He said, no. That what born of the flesh is flesh, and that what's born of the Spirit is spirit. You must be born again. Number 2, I like this part right here, because he had faith in God. He heard God's call. You know, there are people sitting in churches today that have heard the call of God on their life, and they rejected it. I'd rather do it my way. I don't want to do it God's way. There's only one way to do it. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to Him, to the Father, but through me. So we look at verse 8 right here. It says, he heard God's call. Said, then he obeyed and went. Obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. He went. The next part of that is he put it to action. He didn't just say something. He didn't just hear it. He acted on it. That's when I know when somebody's been born again, they're acting and motive, the motives change. Their action changes. Matthew 4:19 says, he said to them, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Now, me and this guy was talking about fishing this way. He said, that's the most relaxing thing I've ever done is fishing. I like to fish. But if you're really catching fish, it's fun, but it's also work. And guess what? It's not over after you catch them. Not for me. We take them home and we clean them. That's more work. Then we have to bag them up and freeze them. And then we know what we're going to do? We're going to have a fish fry. I love to eat fish. You know what? But cooking is work, but I love it. It's not work to me because I love it. So Jesus said, come follow me and I will make you fishers of men. There's something, there's action. That's where people Individuals come in and say they've accepted Christ, they sit on a pew, and there's never any engagement, doesn't engage the world. That's not what Jesus calls us to do. He called us to be fishers of men. Fishing is work. Here's something I learned about fishing too. You have to have that secret honey hole or that secret place. See, I have a friend, Ray. He knows Lake Gunnersville like the back of his hand. He knows it. He said, I want to take you fishing. So we went fishing over there, and he said, you got to put this lure on right here. You got to use this diver right here, and it goes down about 5 to 7 feet. He said, and you're going to catch one. We've been fishing. Finally, I'm just throwing every which way. You know, he's really into it. He's all in. He knows, he's got a rhythm. And I'm just kind of goofing off back there. All of a sudden, I thought I'm hung on a rock. I said, boy. He stops what he's doing. He's watching me. Pulled it out. It was a 5-pound bass. My first one ever out of Lake Gunnersville, a 5-pound bass. I said, thank you to Ray's Guide Service for putting me on this fish. He knew where to go. God knows where to go to. He said, if we're fishers of men, he wants to take us and be part of his activity. Well, he uses me and you. He uses our testimony. He uses our lure. He is the lure. He said, a lure draws fish out. Jesus Christ is the lure. He's still calling. He's still drawing men to himself. He said, follow me. The next command was Matthew 28:19. He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. A lot of people think to come into church is the checkbox. The checkbox is when we go out the door, the mission field's out there. When we go through those doors and we go outside, that's our mission field out there. That's when we engage and go to work. To make disciples, to draw them in, it takes time. We're walking with people. Yes, people have scars. We're messed up. None of us are perfect. And I talk to people like, well, I can't go to church. I'm not perfect. The roof might cave in if I walk in there. I said, brother, you just have no idea. I said, we're a bunch of sinners saved by the amazing grace of God. We all have scars. We're all messed up, jacked up. I said, we have issues. I said, there's no such thing as perfect sinners, but there is such thing as being justified, being sanctified, being glorified is one day when we get to heaven, we have a glorified body. But we are in a process. Sanctification is a process. Sanctification is I'm pursuing God. I'm pursuing being like Jesus. Have you ever been mistaken for looking like Jesus? Well, that would be something, wouldn't it? You know, the three Hebrew boys, they were thrown into the fire. And after it was in there for a little bit, they looked in there and they said, how many people did we put in there? He said, three. He said, well, I see four in there, and one of them looks like the Son of God. They could recognize him. You ever been recognized as being like the Son of God? Boy, that'd be amazing. Be walking that close, be like Enoch. This communion with God and walking that close to him. Making disciples of all nations. Where to go? Number one, he heard God's call. Number two, he obeyed. Number three, as we go through this morning, he worshiped God. If you go back to starting in Genesis 12 and you start going through the chapters, as he left his homeland, he left security, he left mom and dad, he left everything he ever knew. His whole life, everything. So he started on this journey. But everywhere he got to a place to stop and pitch his tent, he built an altar to worship God. Worship is automatic with us. Worship just doesn't happen up here on the platform or in the seats or in the pews or inside a church building. Worship happens when we recognize him for who he is. He is good. He's a wonderful Savior. But he wants to be praised. He deserves our praise. He deserves our worship. Genesis 12:8. Says, from there he went toward the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Building something, building an altar, it took effort, it took time, but he built something. So what if you happened up on that altar out in the wilderness, on that you were on your journey, and you happened, would you recognize and say, something happened right here? Somebody's already been this way before. That's what this all this history is we're learning. We're not treading new water. We're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses that have already proven this. It's already been tested, tried, and proven. We just need to dig in and get in it. Y'all ready? We're going to dig in. We're going to get into it. We're going to leave something here that they'll say, someone's been here and sacrificed to God. By the way this altar's shaped, by the way it's built, it took him time, it took effort, it took money, it took energy. You know, we put our energy into a lot of things. I remember back when I was young, I loved sports. I loved baseball and basketball. I played some football during, you know, whatever the season was. But I loved baseball. I loved softball. Until I was in my 40s, and my grandson, my oldest grandson's hanging on the fence. Run, Granddaddy, run! I said, it's time for Granddaddy to quit playing ball. Then I started coaching. I coached ball. I loved the ball. But I put a lot of energy and effort into that. Why wouldn't I want to put energy and effort into something that's going to last for eternity? Like working for God. Not up here, out there. Making a difference outside the doors for God. Why wouldn't I want to put my energy in it? You know, that was fun, and I was sweating and tired, and I'd come home sometimes to take a shower from work, and we'd go play ball all night. You know, we'd play to midnight or after, playing baseball, softball. But I put energy in. One thing you're going to see here, he had a passion. In just a minute, we're going to see he had a passion. He worshiped God. Genesis 13:4, he built another altar. Genesis 13:18, he built another altar. Genesis 21:33, he built another altar. Everywhere he stopped and pitched his tent, he built an altar to the Lord and worshiped him. He called on the name of the Lord. He didn't have a clue where he was going. He was just following God. Here's what we know today. We're following God, but we have this book and we know how it ends. He didn't know how it was going to end. We have his story to prove it. Abraham did not know where he was going. Verse 9. By faith he made his home in the promised land. Like a stranger in a foreign country, he lived in tents. Lived in a tent. Probably left a good home back there with Papa and Mama and all the brothers and sisters and kinfolk. And lived in a tent. You know, this is temporary housing. I live at 245 McIntosh Estates Drive, Sharpsburg, Georgia. You know what that place is? It's a they put it on the map as a permanent dwelling. When you get it surveyed, after you get one of a house built, the surveyor had to come back and survey it and plat that on there, put that on your map, say, this is where the permanent dwelling is. I got news for you. It's not permanent. I call it temporary housing. It is only temporary because anything can destroy it, and it's not eternal. It's not going to last forever. You move out of that house, it will rot to the ground. It'll just, when something's not lived in, it just goes down. You got to keep it, maintain it, keep it up. So we have him living in tents, in a temporary, he realized that he was in a temporary dwelling. But you know what about a temporary dwelling? Like a tent, you can pick it up and move fast. You can move fast. Now, I'm used to moving a lot of furniture. And people are like, oh, that's a lot of furniture to move. I move furniture every day at work. I did all my life doing hardwood floors and finishing floors and doing remodeling. We had to move furniture. So I learned how to move furniture, you know. So when I got home, my wife, she said, let's move furniture. I said, I've been moving furniture all day. I don't want to move furniture. So I'd come back, and she would be unmoved. She figured out a way to do it. She'd pay big old towels and stick them under the legs, and she could push that thing anywhere she wanted to. I come back, the whole house would be rearranged. She figured out how to move furniture too. So I, you know why I couldn't say nothing? I said, yeah, baby, that looks good. Because I didn't have to do it. Temporary. Being able to move quick. We've learned how to move quickly now compared to those days. But they're dwelling in tent. Verse 10, I want you to look at this. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God. The foundation, building on God's foundation. Then we look at it, he trusted God. A lot of things about faith is about putting our faith and trust in God. Faith, hope. He trusted God. He put his hope in God. He put his passion. He was passionate about it. I love to be around people that are passionate about something. It doesn't take long, and you get around somebody, they like to talk about automobiles, or they like to talk about cooking or food, or you realize in just a little bit what people are passionate about because they like to talk about it. I like to or paint or remodel or cook or and boy, when you first start having grandkids, the pictures come out first thing. Boy, let me show you my grandbaby. We get passionate about it, don't we? We talk about it. We love it. We had to talk about that. I think about Abraham. God gave him a vision and told him, he promised him, he made a covenant with him that he was going to give him a land, another place. He was passionate. He had a passion for them. He was looking forward to not a city. He was looking forward to the city. There's only one whose maker and builder is God. You do realize that we don't get out of here alive. I had a dear, dear friend of mine pass away. I went to his funeral this week. And everybody there was just ranting and raving how he served God. But what was said was, we will get to see him again because Jesus is coming back. I think it's close. I know it's closer than it was yesterday. It's closer than it was 5 minutes ago. Jesus is coming back. Instead, he's going to come back with him. We're going to get to see him again. He's coming back. Jesus is coming back. Are you ready? Do you know that you know that you know that you're born again? He was looking for a new city. John 14, Jesus is comforting his disciples here. He's getting ready. He said, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms, and that if it were not so, I would have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that you may also be where I am. For you know the way to the place I'm going. Thomas. They call him Doubting Thomas, a nickname. Thomas just had a lot of questions, and everybody else had questions, but Thomas was the only one that would say it. The rest of them were thinking the same way. We don't know how to get there. Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Jesus said, okay, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. Because him and the Father are one. I love this part. Revelation 21. Revelation 21 says, John's on the Isle of Patmos. I can't imagine him being there and getting this vision. And he's pinning this down. He said, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. You know the earth is moaning for Jesus to come back and restore it back because when Adam sinned, the sin curse hit the earth too. It's moaning. It's moaning to be restored and rebuilt and renewed. The earth is trembling. It can't wait. It said the earth was cursed when it happened. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. Verse 2 said, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautiful dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them, and they will be and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He was seated on the throne, said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. That's God speaking, telling us that he's going to bring a new earth. He's going to make all things new. You know, he's what he does to us as sinners. When we're born again, we're made new. We're made fresh. That's one thing, that exhilarating feeling when you finally accept Christ, that you've, something changed, a weight come off. You know, the Holy Spirit moves in, you know it. Something radical changes. So this morning, God is still calling. God's still calling people. He's calling you to salvation. He's calling you. Then our next step is baptism. If you are a believer of Christ, what is hindering you from being baptized? That's the next step of going public with your faith. Say, you know what? I want everybody to know that I'm a believer, and that's the way you know, by being baptized. Baptism doesn't save you. It's an outward expression to tell the world where you stand, that I possess, that you possess. You know what I say too? Once you become born again, you get to, I can't help it. I can't help but talk about Jesus. I can't help but share my love. I can't help but share what God done for me. You know that obedience is pleasing to God? Some of my greatest memories is when you ask your kids, or I ask my boys to do something. I call them my boys. They're full-grown men, 41, and the other fixed to be 39. They're full-grown. But to tell them something, and when they were obedient, it made me smile. It did my heart good to make them see that they were obedient. It makes God smile when his children are obedient. When we obey, when we hear the word of God, here's the responsibility of hearers of the word of God. You either receive it or reject it. You got to do something with it. To say I'm just going to straddle on the fence means I'm not going to do nothing with it. To do nothing means you're doing something. You got to respond to it one way or the other. Next thing is, God's still calling. Obedience is pleasing. Worship. Do people know that you are a Christian? I like some conversation we had in the past week. And it's rare. I mean, it's just rare in today's time that people will say, are you a Christian? A couple of weeks ago, I had a question asked at work. Some people that don't really know me, and they said, you a pastor? I said, yes. She said, I thought you were. Even in our workplace, you can be identified by the way you handle yourself, by the way you respond to people. Do people around you know that you're a Christian? Life as we know it is temporary. On this side of death, death is the threshold. When we cross that threshold of death from this life, you're going to step into eternity. But on this side of it, you get to decide which way you're going to go. You heard the old story about real estate. It's all about location, 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 location. Salvation is the same thing. It don't cost you anything, but it's the most precious thing you'll ever own, that you'll ever hold dear to your heart. All the stuff you see around here will one day be burnt up. This is temporary housing. You know what? This is temporary housing. This flesh is temporary housing. We are on a journey. We're a pilgrims on a journey. I used to love to call each other. We used to call in school, we a bunch of guys, we loved John Wayne, and everything was pilgrim. What's happening, pilgrim? You don't hear that kind of talk much anymore, but we are pilgrims. We're just passing through. There's an old song I used to love to sing it. Oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face. There to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. The older I get, the more miles I put in, the older I get, the closer I get. There's a group of people that meet, they call in the third third. I'm either in the third third or I'm in the fourth quarter. I don't know. Time, when you get a contract, when you sign a contract on something, it says time is of the essence. It means it is urgent. It is of utmost importance. Time is of the essence. For salvation, for being obedient, for doing God's work. We have a job to do, church. Are you ready? Are you ready to get? I mean, we have to engage the world with Jesus. Be prayed up. This morning, we get ready to close. You get to make a decision. You can accept what's already been said, what Christ has done. You can accept the word. We looked at Abraham. He was called. He heard the call. God's still calling. Calling for salvation, calling for work, calling for all of us to have a job to do. Next thing is, are we obedient? You know the Holy Spirit is watching right now. God's working. God's working. Holy Spirit can be dealing with you something different than I'm preaching today, but he's been dealing with you this week. So we're going to take a few minutes. I want you to do business with God. It's not about me. It's about him. I'm trying to lead you to him. My thing is, I want to see you in heaven. Every head bow. Just for a moment. We're going to take just a few minutes. Pray and do business with God. Number one, is God calling you to salvation? Salvation can happen right where you are. You can say this prayer, dear God, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. Save me. Come into my heart and save me. I want you to be the manager of my life from this day forward. Maybe God's dealing with you about disobedience. Look, he's asked you to do something or called you to do something. One thing is to repent, to get back right. Disobedience brings separation from God. So maybe this morning you just say, God, I want to surrender my life to you. Lord, I want to get back in right relationship. Lord, I'm sorry. I've disappointed. I've failed you. Lord, I pray for your forgiveness. Lord, restore me into that fellowship that I might be able to, a vessel worthy to be used, that you could take my life and use it for your glory. If you would stand with me. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Maybe you need to come to the altar. There's something about Abraham built an altar, and it was a place not just to come and ask for forgiveness, but it was also a place to come and worship. It was a place to come and unload and pray for healing, pray for assistance, pray for help. Be quiet for a few minutes. Just, you and God do business. He's calling you to come pray. to come join the church, to come be a part of this work.